Diabetes, one of the oldest diseases known to mankind. Yet there is so much conflicting advice from different healthcare camps on how to deal with it. A simple internet search threw up all these suggestions on treatment for diabetes. So who among them have got it right? Hi. This is Aditya Menon on The Lateral Enquirer. On this episode, in the spotlight, is diabetes. It is estimated that we have 77 million people afflicted with diabetes in India alone. That is the second highest spot in the world after China. Despite the huge number, diabetes is the least understood illness among the Indian masses, thanks to the insane spread of unscientific ignorance. Look at this report, for instance. This man, despite being a scientist, listened to a self-proclaimed yoga guru called Baba Ramdev for medical advice in treating his diabetes. It does not matter if one is literate and educated with a science degree. Minus the scientific temper to inquire the rationale behind a claim, one could end up dead. Millions of people die each year resulting from complications arising out of diabetes. Many more become blind from diabetic retinopathy and face kidney failures due to uncontrolled diabetes. In the majority of these cases, the people are aware of their diabetes and are trying to fight the illness, but take advice from absolute quacks, resulting in irreversible consequences or fatalities. So what is the right way to go about keeping oneself safe? Does one listen to traditional healthcare like Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, give heed to homeopathy, or seek refuge in science-based medicines? Every system is trying to offer treatment plans. Who must one listen to? To get to the bottom of this, let's try and get an overview on the history of how humankind came to know of, learn, and understand diabetes. Technically, there are seven different types of diabetes. Four under a branch called diabetes insipidus, two under diabetes mellitus, and one more called gestational diabetes. None of these are related to each other, but they all have one symptom in common: excessive urination. And this is what led to the name. The word diabetes originates from the Greek language, where the word means to siphon. The illness was named after the condition of constantly peeing huge quantities of urine as if your body is being siphoned off of water. Nowadays, in general, when the word diabetes is used as a standalone word, it refers to a metabolic disorder which results in high blood sugar. And that is what will be discussed in this video. The first written reference to what we call diabetes came in the form of the Ebers Papyrus, dating to 3,550 years ago in ancient Egypt. The texts talk about a condition described as to eliminate urine which is too plentiful. We understand this today to be polyuria, a symptom of diabetes. The next reference to the existence of the disease more than 500 years after the ancient Egyptian document is from ancient India, written in Sanskrit documents called Charaka Samhita and Sushruta Samhita, mentioning a series of excessive urination conditions referred to as prameha. Under this classification was a specific condition called madumeha, meaning honey urine. This was perhaps the first record of having identified diabetes mellitus. It also defined two different types of madumeha, one that affects the youth and another that comes with old age. We know them today as type 1 and type 2 diabetes mellitus. Subsequently, through the ages, more traditional forms of healthcare from different parts of the world, ranging from China to the Arab world, records the observation of a disease that results in excessive urination, where the urine is sweet. Every form of healthcare has their own set of explanations about and prescriptions to manage diabetes. Obviously, we cannot cover them all. So for the sake of convenience and to make it India-specific, let's consider comparing only three systems. One, the oldest humoral school of medicine that first wrote about diabetes, the Indian Ayurveda, as it will also represent other humoral systems, including Siddha and Unani found in India. Two, the pseudo-scientific German homeopathy. And three, the global modern science-based medicine. There are three broad sections into which we must break down the understanding these systems of healthcare have with regards to diabetes. One, observation. This is the awareness of the illness. Two, the explanation. Reasons given for contracting the illness. And three, the solution. Treatment plan for the illness. The reason why we need to classify them is simple. Let me explain with an example. Humans have known through the eons that the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. This is the observation made, and the observation remains the same today. But when it comes to explanation for the observation, scientifically, today we know that the Earth spins on its axis, and as it rotates, to us, the observer on the planet, it appears that the sun is traveling across the sky from the east to the west. But what was the explanation that was accorded to us by those in the past? Ancient Egyptians believed that one of their sun gods, Khepri, rolled the sun across the sky like a giant dung beetle. Ancient Greeks believed their sun god Helios was riding a chariot across the sky. So with this example, one can see that the explanation given for a certain observation might be completely not in keeping with reality. Now, let's apply this to diabetes between the three systems of healthcare and understand what their observation was and the explanation for it is. Let us begin with how these three systems observed the illness, starting with Ayurveda. Ayurveda has been aware of the illness for about 3,000 years now. Remember, this was a time before biochemistry. There was no blood test or urine test like we have today. They had to find it out in an indirect way. People peed on the ground back then, and it was observed that the spot where certain people with excessive urination peed would attract ants and flies. They proposed that it may be because their urine is sweet, so they actually tasted the urine of such people and confirmed the urine was indeed sweet. Many years later, when homeopathy was made up in the late 1700s, its conceiver, Hahnemann, had knowledge of the existence of diabetes handed to him by what was called allopathy, which was the then European traditional medicine of which he was once a student and practitioner. Once again, there was no clinical test available to analyze for sugar in the urine when homeopathy was invented. Hahnemann would have had to enlist the services of dedicated urine analysts whose job was to grade urine samples against a chart called the urine wheel by indulging in a process called uroscopy. Their task included classifying urine based on its sight, smell, and taste. If the pee sample they swished in their mouths tasted sweet to the tongue, they would identify it as diabetes. Modern science-based medicine is the youngest among the three, with its rudimentary beginnings in the early 19th century. They too, like homeopathy, were aware of diabetes due to earlier schools of healthcare. However, when it came to testing for diabetes, this school of healthcare in 1841 invented the first clinical test for sugar in urine, putting an end to the disgusting practice of tasting another person's urine, which was still then followed by systems like homeopathy. By 1913, science-based medicines also discovered how to test for sugar in the blood. So, there you have it. All three forms of healthcare had observed diabetes, but the methods of detection differed. Ayurveda and homeopathy had to physically taste urine to detect sweetness, whereas modern science-based medicine invented urine and blood tests to detect sugar. Let's now move on to explanation. The Ayurveda branch of the Indian government's Ministry of Non-Science-Based Healthcare, Ayush, describes what causes Madhumeha or diabetes. You can read it in detail by following the links in the description below. But the overview is that it is a terrible imbalance of all the three doshas of Vata, Pitta, and Kapha. Translated into English, those are what humoral systems call bodily humors. So according to them, diabetes is caused by a change in the proportion of the body's quantity of gas, bile, and phlegm. This is nowhere near what we know of the human body today, but we will come to more of that later. Now, let's look at homeopathy. They describe it using the lexicon devised by Hahnemann, and according to them, the condition of diabetes bears a soric miasmatic background with a psychotic tint. It's almost like describing wine. They also call it the tubercular miasm. Miasms, according to homeopathy, is some sort of bad energy that is inherited like a curse, making you susceptible to certain kinds of illness. Hahnemann used this word miasms to describe all those diseases that he could never cure. When it came to modern science-based medicines, they had absolutely no clue on what caused diabetes, so they gave no explanation and kept investigating for causes. The breakthrough came in 1889, many years after both Ayurveda and homeopathy gave their final words as explanations to what caused diabetes. Modern science-based medicine proved to the world that the pancreas had something to do with diabetes. Not doshas, not miasms. This fact was unknown to both Ayurveda and homeopathy, but it does not end here. In 1902, once again unknown to Ayurveda and homeopathy, modern science-based medicine discovered that there were signaling molecules produced by glands in our bodies, and they called such molecules hormones. In 1921, modern science-based medicine finally isolated a hormone created by the pancreas that regulated blood sugar. They named this hormone insulin. It was only after discovering insulin that modern science-based medicine could finally give an explanation and humankind understood what really caused diabetes. It was the decrease in, absence of, or resistance to insulin that caused diabetes. In all those thousands of years where traditional medicine spoke of humors or doshas and homeopathy spoke of miasms, not one system was able to provide the right explanation for the observation. That brings us to how these three camps of healthcare propose to deal with the illness as per their respective understandings of diabetes. Once again, I turn to the official National Health Portal of India's Ministry of Non-Science-Based Healthcare, Ayush. You can read the elaborate list of herbal concoctions recommended by Ayurveda in the links provided in the description below. But what glares at me is their open declaration that these drugs formulations may be used as a supportive therapy in addition to conventional insulin therapy to prevent long-term complications. False cause fallacy again? If the patient does well, they will credit it to Ayurveda without mentioning that insulin, a discovery of science-based medicine, was also being given. Homeopathy is not far behind. The government portal recommends a list of homeopathic remedies which, as usual, are highly diluted substances past Avogadro's limit, making them nothing but water. The link to that is also provided below. The homeopaths too, as is shown in this case, asks the person suffering from diabetes to continue insulin replacement therapy while taking the homeopathic diluted water. Modern science-based medicine? This is where they become the hero. While traditional healthcare prescribed unverified herbs and homeopathy kept giving sugar balls, in the January of 1922, a 14-year-old boy dying from diabetes in a Toronto hospital became the first person to receive a treatment from the discovery made by science-based medicine, an injection of insulin. Within 24 hours, his dangerously high blood glucose levels dropped to near normal levels. In the years that followed, millions upon millions of people who would have otherwise died not being able to be cured by systems like Ayurveda and homeopathy finally had the chance to extend their life. Let me explain why it's important to detail the explanations and solutions that were accorded by these three healthcare systems. One need not venture into clarifying that neither Ayurveda nor homeopathy had any clue that there was a hormone that was responsible for regulating blood sugar. We know they had no clue because they have given detailed reasons as to what causes diabetes according to their understanding. It is written down in the canonical texts of both Ayurveda and homeopathy. It had to do with doshas and miasms, respectively. The knowledge of diabetes being a metabolic disorder related to the hormone insulin, which all healthcare practitioners today quote, is a discovery of modern science-based medicine. It is also science-based medicine that discovered how to test for sugar in urine and the blood. It is also science-based medicine that discovered to measure the quantity of that sugar in the blood and invented the glucose monitor. It is also science-based medicine that discovered hemoglobin A1C and used HbA1c in 1978 to assess long-term control of glucose levels in the blood. There are many more science-based medicine discoveries related specifically to diabetes that I can add to the list, but the gist I wish to communicate is that almost everything we know today about diabetes is thanks to modern science-based medicines alone. A disease which for eons had been killing people in their youth was finally managed only because of modern science-based medicine. So the next time you meet an Ayurvedic practitioner or a homeopath, watch out for some red flags. If they ask you for your blood report, tell them that is cheating. They should be referring to the urine wheel and tasting the urine. If they use words which their system never knew of, like insulin or blood sugar, to explain the illness, tell them to back off and explain instead using their vocabulary of doshas and miasms. I have read so much material written by both Ayurvedic and homeopathic practitioners, and almost everything mentioned in those texts are discoveries made by modern science-based medicine. To me, that is a con job. Remember the chronology. Diabetes was observed but not understood nor treated successfully till insulin was discovered in 1921. On their own, the alternative cures had discovered nothing close to the actual reasons for diabetes. If they want to explain the disease using science, then they should step aside, get out of the way, and suggest treatment also based on science. Don't you think? Diabetes and its misinformation by the unscientific alternative systems are only a tip of the iceberg. Pretty much every other life-threatening disease which they claim to cure lie in the same basket. I've had plenty of resistance to my last video on homeopathy by practicing homeopaths. That to me is not surprising, as it is their livelihood. And every bit of information that I'm calling out are the details homeopathic practitioners try to bury under misinformation. So, once again, I request that you as a viewer should not accept anything I have claimed in this video without cross-checking it for yourself. All I've done is point you in the direction of where the truth lies in. But the decision to go check it out or not is purely your call. That brings us to the end of this episode. Always consult a proper doctor who has a degree in modern science-based medicine. For I hope, from all that I've communicated in this video thus far, it is evident that only they understand what the disease really is. Thanks for watching this episode on understanding diabetes. Please, don't forget to like this video and share it with as many people as you can. Let's live up to the words in our Indian constitution. It shall be the duty of every citizen of India to develop scientific temper, humanism, and the spirit of inquiry and reform. Jai Hind.